So we did several projects, and really our goal in our group is to push the limits, is to challenge, you know, is there a biological limit to how much we can use? And if so, where is it? And it's basically to provide you guys with options. We don't provide recommendations. We want to provide you with the options. You guys are the ones making the decisions on your operations. And as Eduardo said, we've played around a little bit with comparing Camelina seed versus flax. I won't talk about that just in the interest of time. We're going to focus, though, on cake. And last year we did our last Camelina experiment with laying hens where we pushed it all the way to 30%. Okay, and we'll show some of the results here. So I'm going to break it down, just very briefly touch on some of our data. I'm not going to go into in gory detail, but the three main questions that we sought to answer in our research was, will they eat it? Can they maintain high productivity? And what do the eggs look like that come out of hens that are fed high levels of Camelina cake? So I picked a figure here that kind of is representative of what we saw in most of our long-term experiments. So this was done over 36 weeks, several measurements. And as you can see, the dotted line there, that is what is in the production guide. That is what they say the birds at a particular age would be eating. And again, you can see that that all of our treatments were above the line, but you can also tell that there was a slight reduction in feed intake as you went up, okay? But again, they're all above the line. There's not wholesale rejections going on in the feed trough. Just to push that to the absolute craziness that we did here in this experiment, what we did is we fed diets that had 25% canola cake or canola meal, and we compared that to diets that had 30% Camelina cake. Okay, we'll try and get under there. Cake or solvent extracted meal, and we compared that to a wheat soy control. And I'm just gonna quickly unveil this here. What we actually saw is that among the treatments, we did see a small statistical reduction in feed disappearance or feed intake in the first 6 weeks of the experiment, but not in the last 6 weeks. And we think that was an adaptation thing. Okay, so we think there might be some sort of a volatile fraction in the oil part that might be contributing to part of the feed intake issue. But the ones on the solvent extracted cake or meal did very well. Okay, so will they eat it? Yes, they will eat it. Okay, so the second question, can they maintain high productivity when they're fed diets with high dietary inclusions? So I've translated this into case weight, because you producers, you talk about case weight, not so much about average egg weight, okay? So again, this is 30 dozen case weight, and this is for the same graph that I showed you earlier. And what you can see is that we were able to keep them above the line for the duration of our experiment. So the takeaway here is, can they maintain high productivity? Yes, they can, okay? Again, all of our layer experiments, we formulated the diets on a digestible energy, digestible nutrient basis. So these were balanced diets. They were nutritionally balanced diets. In terms of egg quality, really, we didn't see anything among any of these insanely high inclusions of Camelina co-products. The yolk, the reductions in yolk, at least for the cake, we think that may have something to do with the omega-3s. That is something that's been reported in the literature, that you see a reduction in yolk weight. Now, this is something has not been shown to anybody. You guys are the first ones to see this. This is probably the largest data set ever done on omega-3 content in eggs. We looked at over 600 data points on this one from a single experiment. So again, increasing dietary inclusion of Camelina cake. So what we saw is a shift from saturated fatty acids to polyunsaturated. So you can see there's about a 3% shift away from saturated towards polyunsaturated. This is the interesting part. Again, like I told you, we analyze these diets, we analyze the cake. There is no EPA or DHA in the diets. So that's all coming from the birds, okay? And if we look at it in terms of total omega-3, we see a linear increase from about 1 milligram per gram of liquid egg all the way up to 25% where we've got about 4. Now, why the big thing that I want you guys to take away from this is that is the number that Health Canada sets for being able to make a label claim that a food is a source of omega-3 fatty acids. So we were able to achieve that at 15% dietary inclusion, which is far below the maximum. So what is the quality of the eggs from these hens? It's not too shabby. It's pretty good. Good shell quality, good, you know, fatty acids are being shifted the right way, we think. So what we've learned, again, we think that palatability might be an issue, maybe related to the glucosinolates. But otherwise, we think it's a very good feedstuff, okay? Has a lot of potential, has some problems, just like Eduardo said, but I think we can deal through those. And potentially here, if the cake can enrich the eggs at 15% dietary inclusion, that means you could probably do the same thing with 5% full fat seed, okay? And that's one of the projects that we want to take on here. Processing is critical. Much better if you can roll it, don't hammer mill it. You hammer mill it, you're going to have chickens with little beards of Camelina running around the barn because they it will cake on their beaks.